Good morning, Severn Church. A lot of excitement in here today, so that's good. That's good. All right, children, you're dismissed to go with Miss Jen and Miss Virginia to Children's Church. Welcome. It's nice to see you all today. My son Aaron is here this morning, sitting next to Mom. He's pastor of Crossroads Church in York County, and he's on vacation the entire month of July. So he surprised me this morning, so I'm glad you're here. Let's go to just a few announcements. I'll be on vacation beginning August the 6th through the 19th, and I've got information there, who to contact and who's preaching in my place. And then I'm not going to read about the church directory, but Anita is still trying to put everything together. So please read it. You do not need to be a member to be part of our directory. We want you to be in there. Some people get to see your face and know who you are. So that'll be really, really helpful. All right, do we have any birthdays this week? Mary Lou. Mary Lou has a birthday. Thank you, Doug. Faye has a birthday. All right, anybody else?
Shirley has a birthday. All right, let's sing happy birthday.
Blessed each and every one of us in our daily life and how you've blessed our church over the years. And Father, now just be with us in the worship service in your holy and precious name. Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day.
She shall come.
Amen. Thank you, choir. Thank you, Kenneth. Shirley, it was beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. Open your Bibles this morning to 1 Peter chapter 1. We've been studying the book of James, and now we're going right next door to 1 Peter. 1 Peter. Peter is writing to the same exact people that James is. He's writing to the Christian Jews who were outside the city of Jerusalem, trying to encourage them. Now, 1 Peter chapter 1 is so full of good stuff, I'm only going to get through half the chapter this week. Okay, I'm just going to get through verse 9, because I don't want to run over some of the depth and the things that Peter was saying to the church back then, because we also know it applies to us today. It was written by Peter, the Apostle Peter. It was written about 60 A.D., and again, he wrote it to the Christian church. One of the themes in 1 Peter is that when things get tough in life, we are not to concentrate on our present situation, but we are to look forward to better times that are coming. Am I right? It's easy to get all wrapped up in the present, but the 1 Peter tells us that good days will be coming a little bit later. We need to think about that. I read a story this week about Henry Ford, and when he first made his Model T, he was ready for the transmission, so he ordered the transmissions from the vendor, and he told the vendor, "I want the box cut a certain length. I want the holes drilled for the top this far apart. I want the hole size to be exactly this. And then I will buy the transmissions." Well, the vendor was thinking, what does Henry Ford care about the box as long as it gets shipped safely? So the transmissions come in the box, and Henry Ford takes the box apart, takes the lid off, puts it right on the Model T. It's the exact length. The screw holes have already been drilled, and all they had to do was put the fasteners in, and he had his floorboard already by planning ahead. Now that's smart, isn't it? So we are also supposed to be looking ahead. That's what the Lord wants us to do. So as we progress from the book of James to Peter, a couple things happened. First of all, James was beheaded by King Herod. And Herod saw that it pleased the Jews so much that he also arrested Peter and threw him in jail. So turn in your Bibles, keep your finger in 1 Peter, go to Acts chapter 12, and I'm going to read 9 verses, because I want to make a comparison between James and Peter. Acts 12, 1 through 9. Acts 12, 1 through 9. It was about this time that King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword. When he saw that this pleased the Jews, he proceeded to seize Peter also. This happened during the Feast of Unleavened Bread. After arresting him, he put him in prison, handing him over to the garden to be guarded by 4 squads of 4 soldiers each. Herod intended to bring him out for public trial after the Passover. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. The night before Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter was sleeping between 2 soldiers, bound with 2 chains, and sentries stood guard at the entrance. Suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared, and a light shone in the cell, and he struck Peter on the side and woke him up. "Quick, get up," he said, and the chains fell off Peter's wrists. Then the angel said to him, "Put on your clothes and sandals," and Peter did so. "Wrap your cloak around you and follow me," the angel told him. And Peter followed him out of the prison, but he had no idea that what the angel was doing was really happening. He thought he had seen a vision. Look at verse 10. They passed the first and second guards and came to the iron gate leading to the city. It opened for them by itself, and they went through it. When they had walked the length of the street, suddenly the angel left him. That was pretty miraculous, wasn't it? Peter sound asleep in his cell. And the angel hit him on the side and said, "Get up. You got to go. It's time for you to go." And I love it that Peter just started walking towards the cell and the door open. Then he went through the different gates of the city. The doors opened by themselves, and Peter was able to get away. So the question I had this week was, why was James beheaded and Peter was set free? Those are hard questions, aren't they? Like, why do some people suffer and some people don't, or appear to not suffer? Why do some people have a short life, some people have a long life? And as I did my study, and what I saw was James had fulfilled everything that God wanted him to do in his life. The Bible says that we are all appointed a time that we will pass away. James had finished everything. He had written his letters. He had done everything that God wanted him to do. And then God said, "It's time for you to come home to your reward. Come on, there's an inheritance for you." He wasn't finished with Peter yet, though, because Peter needed to be there for the Apostle Paul. Peter needed to be there to write the book of Revelation. But after God had finished, or after Peter had finished everything that God had intended him to do in his life, Peter also was executed. Anybody remember how Peter was executed? He was crucified. And he was crucified upside down. Because he said he wasn't worthy to be crucified the same way as Christ, his Savior. So Peter also was executed. Now, you're thinking, why would anybody want to follow Christ if you know that it may lead to you being killed for your faith? But didn't Jesus say, "The world will hate you just like they hated me, so do not be discouraged or afraid that I will be there with you"? These two men had faith. How do you think your faith would stand up if soldiers came in this morning and told you that to renounce your belief in Jesus Christ or you would lose your life? You might say, "Well, that's not going to happen." It happens every day in Iraq. Iraq went through Nineveh, where they were primarily Christians, and destroyed everything. ISIS went through there and destroyed everything. Their churches. They killed Christians. That's present day. 22,000 Christians lost their life last year in the Middle East because they believed in Jesus Christ. We're very blessed in this country, aren't we? We wake up on Sunday mornings, get a shower, get dressed, go to church. We're not worried about anybody stopping us in a blockade. We're not worried about anyone busting in the church and asking us to renounce our faith. So why? What would you do? I pray that I would be strong enough to say, "I am not going to renounce my Savior. You do whatever you have to do." It's something to think about, isn't it? Because I do believe in the last days that we will live in perilous times as Christians. Things are just starting to get cranked up. This country is not what it was 50 years ago. Christians were respected. If you said you were a Christian, It was no big deal to someone else. But you say you're a Christian today out in public, they look at you like you got two heads on your shoulders. It may not happen in my lifetime, but my dear friends, I do believe there will be a time when you will lose your life because of accepting or having accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Be strong, right? You can go through the Old Testament and read all kinds of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, David, all these people faced adversity in their lives, but yet their strength and their faith stood firm. I pray that you have that type of faith today. All right, enough about that. Let's go to 1 Peter, or I'll never get out of here and get some lunch. 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning with verse 1. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. Does anybody know why he's called an apostle? He's called an apostle because he saw Jesus Christ. That's why the disciple, the resurrected Jesus Christ. That's why the disciples went from being disciples to apostles. I mean, that's why we call him the Apostle Paul. Jesus had already been crucified, but Jesus showed himself to Paul on the road to Damascus. And he called him out by name, so we call him the Apostle Paul. So, just a little tidbit right there. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. To God's elect, strangers in the world. We should be strangers in the world, shouldn't we? Scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. I didn't say that right. Bithynia. Stop laughing, sissy. I do the best I can. Who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father through the sanctifying work of the Spirit for obedience to Jesus Christ and the sprinkling in His blood, by His blood, grace and peace be yours in abundance. The first couple words in here have always thrown me for a loop. To the elect. When he says the elect, some denominations believe that God already knows who's going to be saved and who's not going to be saved. So there's absolutely no reason to evangelize. There's no reason to talk to people about Christ because of God already knows that God has pointed you and you and you and you and you will be saved. But if you stop and think about it, I do believe God knows who's going to be saved and who's not. But if that's the case, why did Jesus have to die on the cross? If the minute you were born, God said, I want that one. God gave us all free will, didn't He? To make the decision about whether to accept Christ or not. So when I looked at this, to God's elect, He's writing to the Christians. Who was God's elect before the Christians? The Jews. The Jews. So when He says here, to God's elect, He's writing to you. Did you know you're God's elect this morning? Because if you elect to believe in Jesus, He'll elect to bring you into heaven and be with Him forever and ever. Does that make sense? Okay, teaching now. Here we go. Now, in Rome, during this period of time, the Romans really didn't care if someone was Christian or Jewish. They didn't hunt them down because in their mind, Jews and Christians were the same. Now, this infuriated the Jews because they couldn't stand the Christians. So the Romans really didn't care if the Christians were meeting over here or over there or whatever, because they just really didn't care about that. And if a Jewish person converted to Christianity, the elder of the family, which is always the oldest male, could proclaim that they are disowning you as a child of theirs, and it's as if you had never existed. The Bible talks about blotting your name out in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's what the Jews did. If you became a Christian, Neil, your parents would blot your name out as they wrote the history of the family, and Neil was as if he had never existed. There was a price to pay to accept Christ, wasn't it? I ain't heard an amen since I got started. I'm going to sit back down. Stay with me now. In verse 2, we see the works of the Trinity. The Holy Spirit, Jesus, and God the Father. Look at it again. And this is what they do for our salvation. God the Father, through the sanctifying work of the Spirit, for obedience to Jesus Christ and sprinkling by His blood. So you see here, the Trinity each has a role in salvation. The Father offered us salvation. Jesus died for our sins. And the Holy Spirit sets us apart and instills in us the benefits of salvation. Christ has given each and every one of us new birth. You know, you hear evangelists and preachers say, you must be born again. Well, if someone who had never been to church before, I never read the Bible before, that's a strange saying, isn't it? You must be born again. See, Nicodemus went to Jesus and said, Nicodemus was a ruler with the Jews. He was in the Sanhedrin. There were 72 of them. They made sure everybody did what they were supposed to do. They'd walk along the road like, you're not supposed to carry that. You're not supposed to pick that up. You're not supposed to eat that. So he was a big deal in the Jews. And he went there at nighttime to Jesus because he was really, I guess he was questioning who Jesus was. And he asked him, he said, are you a teacher from God? Jesus explained who he was, and he said, in order to inherit the kingdom of God, you must be born again. So how would we explain that to somebody? Because when you accept Christ, your old self dies. Your sinful old self dies, and when you accept Christ, you are a new person. You know somebody who accepted Christ and all of a sudden they were entirely different than they were? That's what the Holy Spirit does. That's what the Holy Spirit will do for you. Your old life is dead and now you're new in Christ. All right, let's look at verse 3. Praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So how do we get this new hope? Through what? The resurrection of Jesus Christ. And into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you, who through faith is shielded by God's power unto the coming of salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that your faith of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may be proven genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen Him, you love Him. And even though you do not see Him now, you believe in Him and are filled with the inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. We have an inheritance, don't we? We have an inheritance that the Bible says that nobody can destroy it. We have an inheritance that's there for us when we get to heaven. One of those is the mansion that God has prepared for us. I can't wait to get in my mansion. I bet it's going to be beautiful. But see, what Peter is doing is saying, you look around now at your present situation, that is not where God's going to intend for you to stay forever and forever. This world will pass away. The things that we know will pass away, but wow, when you get to heaven, there is something there that's grand and it's an inheritance. And whatever pain you experience in this life, just know that that's not your final destiny or experience. The Jews looked forward to their inheritance. It was called the Promised Land. We as Christians look forward to our inheritance, and it's called heaven. I heard a few amens. Y'all, would y'all take sleeping pills before you come to church this morning? But we may have to endure trials during this time. And the Bible says that they can kill your body, but they cannot touch your soul. Your soul belongs to Jesus. There was a ritual among the Indians that when a young man came to the age where he should become a warrior, they would take this young man out in the woods, deep in the woods, and draw a circle around him and told him that until tomorrow morning, you're not to leave this circle. He had no knife. He had no bow and arrow. And the young man would sit down in the circle and just wait. And as it got dark at nighttime, he could hear the animals howling and screeching and roaring. They were testing him to see how his courage was. And probably about 2 o'clock in the morning, terrified of what he heard, knowing he couldn't protect himself, this young man fell asleep. When the sun came up, he woke up. He looked around, and what he didn't know is that his father was standing behind a tree with a bow and arrow pulled back in case something was coming to hurt his boy. He didn't see that. The Bible says we don't or may not see God's protection, but it's there. We have a Heavenly Father that's there with His bow and arrow ready to protect us in this life. Deuteronomy 3:24 says, "You have only just begun to show me your servant, how very great and powerful you are." We don't have an idea how great God is. We see miracles. We see things happen, but our God is a great God, isn't He? And He's that big to watch over us and to guard us. And I like what Paul says, "For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, not height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." When you're a Christian, when God's got you as His child, He's got you. And nothing's going to snatch you out of that hand. In verse 7, as we begin to close, Peter talks about how God refines us through suffering. And he talks about the gold. The man who worked with gold is called the master smelter. And he stirs the gold in a pot as the impurities begin to rise, and then he scoops off the impurities. And he keeps doing that until he can see his face in the gold. Then he knows it's ready. You and I are ready, my friend, when Jesus can see Himself in us, in our life. But we have to do this through God's help, because we can't do this on our own, can we? Because we're weak. This past week, I learned how weak I was. For some reason, I got selected in our softball league to be in a home run hitting contest. Oh, my is right. You had to hit off a tee, which I had never hit off a tee before. Wesley got selected also. And Wesley hadn't hit off a tee. So we got together and we practiced. And man, I was ready. You know, we had an announcer. He said, "Now up to bat, Pastor Bill West." My son Aaron and his wife were over there. And they're like, "Hey, come on, Dad, you can do this." So, you know, I dig in with my foot. I get things ready, set the ball on there, and I swing. I hit the tee, didn't hit the ball. The tee fell down. The ball went about 3 feet, and I said, "Anybody see where that went?" So the next pitch, I remembered what Wesley had taught me. And so I got ready. I cranked, Dustin, I was going to crank it. And I hit that thing just as pretty, went to center field. I said, "She's gone." till the center fielder caught it 10 feet in front of the fence. And I knew then I was in trouble because that was the best I could do, and it was not good enough to get it over the fence. I knew I was weak. So I swung 8 more times. We had 10 swings. I swung 8 more times knowing there ain't no way in the world I can hit one over that fence. Now, let me just tell you, Wesley did. Wesley could crank them, buddy. I'm telling you. I was just in awe of the ones that he hit. But what I realized when I was going home is that in my mind, I thought I was strong enough. You know what I mean? But age has a way of creeping up on us. And weakness comes along with age, where you just can't do what you used to do. And that's what the Bible is telling us. You, Pastor Bill, are too weak to get to heaven on your own. You are too weak for salvation. You can't do it yourself. You can't be good enough, can't go to church enough, can't read the Bible enough. But me, as Jesus, I can bring you. I can hit that ball over the fence for you. So step out of the way, because home runs are coming. That's what our Lord does for us. That's what He does for us. When we are weak, the Bible says He is strong. That's what we need to remember in our life. When things get hard, things get tough, better days are coming. No matter how weak you are, your Heavenly Father is strong enough. And your Heavenly Father draws that circle around you, and you are His child in there, and He's watching you all the time. That's what 1 Peter 1, 1 through 9 tells us. So you have to come back next week to see the rest of the chapter. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank You for the encouragement of the Scriptures this morning. God, I pray that You'll be with us during this time, Lord, and may today have encouraged some people in their life. In Jesus' name, amen.
In these times of uncertainty today, Severn Church would like to remind everyone that you can still tithe on the church website, www.severinchurch.faith, or email your tithes to Severn Church, 9066 Robins Neck Road, Gloucester, Virginia, 23061. Thank you for your generosity.